So let's take a step back and talk about why startups are hard. So the first reason that I attribute is this myth of the visionary entrepreneur. And in our present time, one of the most visionary entrepreneurs that we know of is Steve Jobs. And when we look at him, we kind of see a graph that looks like this. Is lately he has had the Midas touch. Every product he has built has been an instant success, from the iPod to the iPhone to the iPad, which was, in his words, one of his biggest achievements. But he also talks about how it was one of his biggest achievements of his career. And so we fail to realize that even in that revolutionary visionary device, there's a string of iteration, there's a string of evolution from software and hardware all the way to even failures along the way. So for those of you that had or can remember back the original tablet that Steve Jobs built was the Newton One, which was a massive failure. Probably people in the room who owned one. I owned the Newton Two, and really loved the device, but still, you know, it didn't work. It had very advanced technology like handwriting recognition, which never quite worked. He didn't fail once, but he failed twice with that. And along the way, he had been doing all these different things, and there's this string, and lately you can actually tie back. Even if you take the iPad and put it next to the iPhone, you'll see a string of evolution from design, hardware, software that can be traced back to everything they've done. And that's what we talk about, is that it's not this perfect time launch, but for most startups, the product life cycle looks something like this. Is when we are first starting out, we have an inkling of what the problem is, what the solution is, but those are just guesses. We don't even quite know who the customers are. We think we know who they are. And so when we launch, we don't actually hit any of the customer adoption curves. In reality, there's not one, but there are many. For any given product, as we'll see in some of the exercises later on, with just a few tweaks, you can repurpose it for many different customer segments. And so when you launch, more than likely, you're not going to get what we call product market fit. It's not going to be an overnight success. No one's going to really care. And so then the real search begins. Then the process of iteration begins. And what we're looking for is finding one of those curves that we can latch onto, we can intersect with. And that is the search for product market fit. The second thing that I find that kind of gets in the way is actually product development. And this is a little bit hard to understand or hard to digest at first, because building products is what we're really here to do. But the reason for that is if we look at a typical product development cycle, this can be applied to many kinds of products. You actually start with the requirements phase, where we go and interact with customers, try to understand what it is we want to build. And these may not even be interacting with customers. They might be internal product teams that come up with features that we need to get built. But the idea is that we do some amount of work to define the specs of what we want to build. Then we go out and we build it. We go through a quality assurance cycle, and then we finally release this out to the world. Now, the problem with this model is that while some learning happens during those early stages, most of the learning only happens after we release a product. There's this big middle where we go away for several weeks, months, and in some cases, even years at a time, where we're just building stuff and testing it. And while we're learning about things like quality and the ability to, technical feasibility, the fact that we can build very complicated things, put it out there, we're not really learning. And in the lean startup, we measure learning, not just, learning about technical risks and things like that, but we want to know, are we learning about customers? Are we learning, where the markets really are? And so down here, I have a Steve Blank quote, which is actually based on a study that was even done in Silicon Valley, where they studied, I think, a cohort of 1,000 startups. And every one of them that set out to build a product actually succeeded at building the product they set out to build. What they failed at doing was actually finding the customers and markets for those products. And so that is the bigger risk that we face. And so there are exceptions, of course, and we like to talk about those too. If you are in a situation where there's high technical risk, so if you're trying to find the cure for cancer, for example, in those cases, some of these early ideas of doing problem validation, customer validation are kind of senseless. You're not going to go and ask people, would you like the cure for cancer, or do you need this, or would you pay for it? We know that's a pressing. So that's an example where a problem is well known. The solution is what's riskiest, and we'll talk about how even that fits this model of iteration. But the idea that I was trying to put out here is that for the general folks, what we're really plagued with is not really technical risk, but it's customer and market risk. And all that we are trying to do with the Lean Startup process is reduce that cycle time. So there's some learning that we're doing during requirements and release. What we're trying to do is, can we instill customer learning throughout that product development cycle? So can we learn while we're building and testing? And so we'll talk about ways of doing that. So one thing I didn't mention in the beginning is I do like these to be very interactive, conversational. So if you do have a question and want to ask it, you know, go ahead and ask it right away so you don't lose the train of thought. But we'll also have breaks if you want to ask more detailed, specific questions. But I'm happy to take questions at any time. So the third reason that I attribute to startups being hard is that we hear this all the time, is that you have to listen to customers. The more important thing is you have to know how to listen to customers. So many people have tried, have tried myself included, to go and talk to customers and ask them what they want. And people that have tried it have actually failed because they always attribute this code, is that, you know, even Henry Ford was not able to get customers to tell him what they wanted. But what they failed to realize is that even in this statement, there is a problem statement that's hidden. So customers are great at articulating their problems. They may not be that visionary. Some, of course, are, but they may not be that visionary at coming up with the solution. And they shouldn't be, because that's not their job. That's really your job. So even in this statement, there's a hidden problem. And what they're really saying is that they're not happy with their existing horse. What they want is something faster than their horse. And someone like Henry Ford was able to see beyond the projected solution and go invent the automobile and find a way to deliver a solution that met that problem that the customer had. And that's a theme that we will hear over and over again, which is best summarized by the Steve Jobs quote, is that it's not the customer's job to know what they want. And it hits the nail right on the head, because what we want to do with customers is not go and get a feature spec from them. It's not to go and ask them what it is that we build. We don't want to ask them how much we charge for these products. All of those are really your job. What we want to really understand is, what is their worldview? What problems are they facing? And then we go out and build the best possible solutions for those specific problems.